They were cassette tapes of my band at the time, and I got pulled in, and they were searching and like all for my clothes and stuff, and they saw the picture, and they're like, "Oh, you're in a band?" I'm like, "Yeah," and the customs lady, she goes, "Oh, well, that's why you have so much weird stuff." I'm like, "Are you allowed to say that?"
I don't know. That sounds illegal. Like. Yeah, that sounds like a case for the ACLU or so. Well, wait a minute. The Canadian Civil Liberties Union, I don't know. Do you have anything like that up there that would sue on your behalf or anything?
Oh, could be. Probably. I don't know. Too much trouble.
In this day and age, who knows? If they don't have one, maybe we just talk somebody into starting one. How did you ever – I got to ask this because this was in my mind from the moment I first started looking at your song titles here. How did you come up with the concept of doing a piece of music based on this semi-imaginary creature that half of us have never heard of before?
It's such a long story because it would kind of go around in circles. Sometimes you just have ideas and, you know, hear a word or be reading. I mean, by day, I'm a mild-mannered librarian, so I tend to read a lot, and I tend to read a lot of, you know, witchcraft stuff, and you know, and nonfiction stuff too, not so much fictional stories, but which a lot of that stuff is interwoven anyway, right? The real and imagined, and So that's kind of where, you know, you hear something and it just sticks with you. I have notes,
sure,
and guitar riffs and all kinds of stuff in my phone. I probably have 200 of them, you know, just all the time that I'm kind of...
It may have been a long, circuitous story, but you sure summed it up very well, and I understand completely. As a matter of fact, lately we've been talking a lot with artists about what they have done during the down period of this pandemic, and many of them have expressed the fact that it has helped them to take the time to bring out their own creativity, and they've gone to different lengths than they have in the past to come up with some music concepts and tunes, and you have just really stepped right into that and explained how you have done the same thing. And John Bon Jovial, I know, has been sitting there coming up with an incredibly clever question.
Sure.
Okay.
Call it that. Darren, actually, while I'm listening to the making of a homunculus.
a little creature.
Yes, a little creature. The thing that I want to know is, what was your influence for putting that together? A lot of the music, you know, like this style of guitar, I call it like a slasher guitar, has never really been, I've never been a fan of it, but there are a few exceptions. And one of those bands is a band called Focus. They came out with an album in 1970 called Moving Waves. And this style of guitar is very reminiscent. I don't know if you've heard of them, but I just want to know what your influences were. What was the thought process? What inspired you to making of a homunculus?
Well, to be honest, that song, you know, each album is going to become more of me, I guess you could say. This one, Wonders of the Invisible World, the new album that has all kinds of stuff, but that song just sort of felt like the most, the best representation of my playing and writing. Doesn't mean I can't do other stuff, but that's just kind of where I come from, I guess. That band, I have not heard of that, so I got to check that out.
Yeah, the band is called Focus, and the album Focus is Moving Waves, and it came out, I believe it was 1970, 69 or 70 that it came out.
Amazing, some of that stuff that back then.
Yeah,
and that you find now.
Yeah, look into it. I'm sure you can find them on YouTube.
All right, so I'm sure you have. I spend way too much time on YouTube, I think.
Yeah, well.
But I'm finding some great, some just absolutely amazing new music that I keep finding, and it's like I can't believe people say. Still, you know, people will say, "Oh, there's no good music being made today," and like it, to me, that's just like the laziest thing to say, because it's like, it's insulting to those of us who are making music, but more than that is there's tons of great stuff out there. You just have to look for it, you know, and that's why what you guys are doing is so important, because it's exposing people who actually want to find new music to different artists.
That's one of the things we've tried to do, that, and of course, give a stage, one more venue for indie and emerging artists and artists who haven't gotten the exposure to expose their music and talents. And thank you. That was appreciated, because that's
very
exactly
much.
What
very
we're trying much. To do here. Now, I've got to ask you, I understand that you had a challenge to overcome here not too long ago from an auto accident.
Yeah, that was before the Lifting the Curse album, and that's kind of what set me on this path of doing instrumental music in the first place, because my whole life, all I've ever done is play with bands, and I'm perfectly happy doing that. But after the accident, I couldn't do the same. I mean, it was kind of knocked out of commission for a few years, and not so much physically, although even today I'm sore. I still feel it, but it was psychological. It was, financial complications. The accident was entirely the other driver's fault, but, you know, these things, litigation, all that takes years, and just it wears on you. And, you know, so the short version of this is basically that I needed to do something, and I just kept creating music. It, very similar to what artists are going through today, where the world is on pause, but they still need to do something. So it's exactly the same thing. I was just writing, and I was like, well, I don't have a band that really this fits with. And so I made a video, and people seemed to like it. I just kept, somewhere along the way, it turned into a legitimate project as I healed. So it was kind of a therapeutic process.
That's wonderful, and I can't help but think of the comparison going back a few decades. The king of the surf guitar, Dick Dale, from the 60s, who was, you know, one of the penultimate guitar players of that type of music from that era, was involved in a fire which burned his hands, and they said he would never play a guitar again. And I remember I was living in Southern Cal at the time, in one of the suburban towns, you know, one of the bedroom communities about 30 miles out of the LA, and they had a Christmas parade, and Dick Dale was the grand marshal of the parade, and, you know, he's riding down the street in this car, waving and everything, and it really awakened mine, as well as other people from the era, curiosity about what he was doing, and it turns out that he was back to playing guitar. He had overcome the same thing, only he had actually gotten better than he was before, which I thought was a remarkable achievement for someone who they said would never be able to play a guitar again. But I can compare it to what you just said, what you went through, and the fact that you overcome that for a specific purpose that helped you in your efforts to overcome it. And I congratulate you for that. That's
thank you.
That's definitely quite an achievement.
Well, and you know, a lot of this, when I first put out the first album and started talking to people, I was a little uncomfortable even talking about it, because, you know, you think, well, I mean, you can look in any direction and somebody has it worse than you do. So I didn't want to seem like I'm trying to get attention for my, you know, what happened, because I'm still here to complain about it. You know, it could be a lot worse. But then the other side of it is that it is part of the human experience. It's something that's relatable. Not everybody has a car accident, but nobody gets through this life without, you know, trauma and
some kind of
sadness, and, you know, yeah. And so it's just sharing the story, I guess, that's helped me to get to where I am right now. So,
well, from where you are right now, where are you going? Assuming that we get through this pandemic and things return to some semblance of normalcy, what's in the future for you?
Well, you know, I'm going to keep making these albums, and as far as, you know, people say, well, people don't buy albums and that. The new album, this is something I should tell you, anybody listening who wants it, the CD, I have it on my website right now for free. You have to pay the shipping, I can't do that, but you get the album for free. I don't know how long I'm going to keep it up there like that, but it's a pay-what-you-want situation, because I just love the CD. I love having that product in my hand, and I want other people to experience it because the CD is really cool. As far as what's next, you know, I'll keep doing it. I would love to get out on the road. I really, like now more than ever, want to be touring. And, of course, nobody's really, you know, in that situation.
Not a lot of it right now.
No,
would you let him, one other thing that I wanted to move to next after we discussed your future, and that was the talk about your CD and the website. And before I give it to John, I just want to mention that one of our things that we hold dear here is this is a stage for you to pitch yourself. So tell the folks how they can find you and your music online.
Well, the best thing you can do, I would say, is to go to DarrenBoyd.com because everything, you can find me on YouTube from there and Instagram. I spend a fair bit of time on Instagram. So, yeah, that's if there's any way to find me, DarrenBoyd.com is the first step. And, of course, you can just search for me on YouTube, and I'm there, too. So.
And don't forget that free album. Hurry, folks, while supplies last. John Bon Jovi, you're on. What you got?
Well, just a real quick question. You mentioned that you're releasing it on a CD. Are you also going to be releasing it on vinyl?
Not yet. I've been thinking about that for a while, but it kind of seems like, and I could be totally off the mark here, but it seems like a lot of people want to buy vinyl. I mean, it's merch, really, you know, and it's expensive. So it's a lot easier to sell it if you're out on the road or if you have a really good fan base already. And right now I'm still in that building stage, you know, so I would love to. I would love to do that. And, you know, if there becomes a demand for it, then, it's never out of the question.
Great. And before we let you go, we got a couple of minutes left here for you to tell us about this next tune. We're going to play Wonders of the Invisible World.
Oh, yeah. There's a video for that, too, which is hilarious because when I put the album out, it was right around Halloween. And when it was released, it was like 2 weeks before. I'm like, oh, geez, I need a video. I need something. So I went into my rehearsal spot and I just filmed me playing the parts on different instruments. And it's just ridiculous. That it looks like the height of laziness because I didn't even use a filter. And it's just me jamming with myself, you know. And
I'm
the
glad
video's kind of funny.
I'm glad you brought that up, folks, because, I'm getting you and the audience mixed up here. Darren, we're glad you brought that up. Folks, listen, you've got to go see that video. And as I said, I'm glad you brought it up. It is definitely worth tuning into. Go look it up, the video for Wonders of the Invisible World by our guest, Darren Michael Boyd. Darren, thank you so much for coming and spending time with us today, sharing your music and your story. And, please keep in touch with us. I have a page on Facebook. I tell everybody about my groups page, the David Bowers Awards groups page, is there specifically for guests of the show and other indie artists to post their music, their new releases, show dates, anything that they want to share. You post it there. We'll pick it up and post to our other social media and sites around the internet that we post to. So that's there specifically for you to use. So keep in touch with us. Let us know what's going on.
Wonderful. Thanks so much.
You're very welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Darren Michael Boyd, and here he is with Wonders of the Invisible World.